Oh, what a warm greeting. I can't tell you about the goose pimples that run up and down my spine thinking that I'd get that kind of a greeting in front of this incredible orchestra, this incredible choir that I have been invited to be present for and participate with in this Christmas presentation. They called my office and asked and invited through my chief of staff me to come here, and she called me at my home, where I still was that morning, and said, "Do you think you could do it?" I said, "Think I can do it? I'm on my way." I couldn't imagine a greater privilege than to be here with this orchestra and this choir. My parents, I think, were among the very first people 73 years ago who were tuned into the Sunday broadcasts with the old crystal set, and they became faithful listeners throughout the radio years, and I've sat with them and also admired the wonderful musicianship of this marvelous organization. And I would like to think that they are tonight incredibly proud of what little Walter ended up doing in being in front of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. It does my heart a lot of good. And I want to thank you all for this incredible reception, the warmth of everyone here in Salt Lake City, it seems, and certainly those who've come into this absolutely gorgeous, incredible hall is one of the nicest things that could happen to me. Thank you all so very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, you all know of this unparalleled record in broadcasting history that Mr. Cronkite has. But we found out that he is also a conductor. He has appeared with the United States Marine Corps Band. And we thought then he should appear with the Mormon Tabernacle Choir as well. Mr. Cronkite, we are going to give you a special baton. It says Walter Cronkite with an etching of the facade of the Tabernacle organ. And with this, we have asked Mr. Cronkite if he would conduct the great Hallelujah Chorus from Handel's Messiah. So would you welcome Mr. Cronkite to the podium.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome once again Walter Cronkite.
The story that you are about to hear is a true story. The faces that you will see are the faces of the families of the choir and orchestra. The 1900s, the final century of the recent millennium, brought unprecedented possibilities and promise. The children of these 100 years would see more improvement in the human condition than ever before in the world's history. Advances in medicine, science, and industry would all but eradicate disease, extend human life, open a dialogue among the peoples of the earth, and lift them into the vast reaches of space. But these hardly seemed like possibilities as the Christmas of 1914 drew near. The nations of Europe were at war. Anxious to expand and defend their borders, they summoned their best and brightest to the battlefront. Young men answered by the millions. A 19-year-old German boy left his job in London to enlist in the German army. English boys working and studying in Hamburg and Paris returned to London, put on their uniforms, and went back to fire upon former friends. Secretary of War Lord Kitchener expanded the British Army overnight by allowing schoolmates to enlist together. The tragedy of these battalions was no more evident than at Somme, France. Hundreds of villages on both sides lost almost all of their young men in a single battle. The little paybook that every British soldier carried included a last will and testament, and thousands of these booklets were collected from the bodies of young boys, many reading simply, "I leave everything to my mother." With hardly a backward glance, the promise of youth was poured into the blind and futile aggression known as the Great War, World War I. The new century brought a new kind of warfare. Field commanders quickly realized that digging in was the only way to survive the sweep of machine gun fire. The German army had marched across Belgium before being stopped at Flanders Field. Some 60 yards away, British, French, and Belgian troops languished in trenches infested with rats and lice, pelted with freezing rain and shrapnel. As temperatures dropped, disease took hold. Snipers picked off those who raised their heads above those earthen walls. The war was but 4 months old, each side losing thousands a day, both to bullets and that silent common enemy, influenza. Between the opposing trenches was an area about the width of a football field, no man's land, littered with barbed wire and frozen corpses. It was a sobering reminder of what the future might bring. Soldiers who survived later recalled their brothers being gathered up and stacked like cords of wood. By war's end, more than 10 million would be lost. Not surprisingly, given the circumstances, most of the soldiers were religious and many were Christian. On Sundays, communion was passed in trenches on both sides, often to the sound of church bells ringing in nearby villages. The occasional hymn was sung, and youthful voices were heard across enemy lines. By December, the war slowed, and hopes for a quick resolution faded away. As the soldiers contemplated their desperate situation, nights grew long and hearts yearned for peace. December 23rd, a group of German soldiers quietly moved to the ruins of a bombed-out monastery. There, they held their first Christmas service. Later on that night, a few Christmas trees, Tannenbaums as they were called, began to appear along the German fortifications, their tiny candles flickering in the night. Across the way, British soldiers took an interest in those lights as they sang together the carols of their youth. Word spread, and heads peeked cautiously over sandbags at the now thousands of Tannenbaums glowing like Christmas stars. Two British officers ventured over to the German line and, against orders, arranged a Christmas truce. But the negotiation was a mere formality by then. Up and down the trenches, men from both sides already had begun crossing the line to join in the celebration. Lieutenant Sir Edward Hulse assaulted the enemy with music. In a letter to his mother, he wrote, "We're going to give the enemy every conceivable song, from carols to Tipperary." The Germans responded with a Christmas concert of their own. It was not long before the cold air rang with everything from "Good King Wenceslas" to "Auld Lang Syne." The next 2 days, those tidings continued to spring from the hearts of common men who shared the common bond of Christmas. Further down the line, a German violinist stood atop his parapet, framed against the skeletons of bare trees and shattered fortifications, and delicately perched in this desolate landscape. His cold fingers conveyed the poignant beauty of Handel's Largo. Whatever the spirit of Christmas had been before that hour, it was now, above all, the spirit of hope, of peace. A British war correspondent reported that later the soldiers heard a clear voice singing the beloved French carol, "O Holy Night." The singer, Victor Granier of the Paris Opera. The night watch must have lifted their eyes toward the heavens as they heard his plaintive call.
Sola
Christmas Day dawned over the muddy fields, and both sides cautiously picked their way through the barbed wire. Side by side, they buried their dead. A German officer known only as Thomas gave Lieutenant Hulse a Christmas gift, a Victoria Cross and letter, which had belonged to an English captain. Lieutenant Hulse responded by giving the German officer his silk scarf. One German retrieved a photograph of himself in uniform and asked his former enemies to post it to his sister in Liverpool. Men who had shot at each other only days before gathered in a sacred service for their fallen brothers. Prayers were offered, and the 23rd Psalm was read.
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Nineteen-year-old Arthur Pelham Byrne, who hoped to study for the ministry after the war, remembered the Germans formed up on one side, the English on the other, the officers standing in front, every head bared. Yes, I think it is a sight one will never see again. As the Christmas of 1914 drew to a close, soldiers who had sung together, played together, and prayed together returned to their trenches. They must have felt reluctant to let the common ground between them become no man's land again. But even as the darkness fell around them, a lone voice floated across the few yards of earth on which they had stood together. In the true spirit of Christmas, one voice and then another joined in. Soon the whole world seemed to be singing, and for a brief moment, the sound of peace was a carol every soul knew by heart.
All is calm.
And that's the way it was one Christmas almost 100 years ago. And that's the way it can be as we embrace the message of that silent, holy night.